JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for April the 9th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar traded lower or unchanged against the other G10 currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian morning Thursday. It lost ground versus Aussie, Kiwi, the pound, and the Norwegian krone in that order, while it was found virtually unchanged against the euro, the Canadian dollar, the Swiss franc, the Japanese yen, and the Swedish krona. The strengthening of the risk-linked currencies Aussie and Kiwi, combined with the relative weakness of the safe havens US dollar, yen and franc, suggests that investors' appetite was boosted again. Indeed, although major EU indices traded slightly in the red, the US ones gained on average around 3%, with the positive sentiment rolling into the Asian session today. Despite Japan's Nikkei falling 0.18%, China's Shanghai Composite, Hong Kong's Hang Seng, and South Korea's KOSPI are up 0.46%, 0.72%, and 1.41% respectively. Now, risk appetite may have been subdued during the European session as Eurozone finance ministers struggled to agree on a coordinated rescue package, with their chairman Mario Centeno suspending the talks until today. That said, things have changed during the US trading, perhaps due to new signs that the coronavirus spreading may be leveling off. Although new infected cases accelerated somewhat, deaths slowed decently. We can see that on the graph I'm posting almost on a daily basis. You can see that infected cases, the gray line, accelerated somewhat while the deaths slowed. At this point, it's worth mentioning that in the US, both cases and deaths have slowed somewhat, with President Trump saying that they might be getting to the top of the curve. US indices may have also received an additional boost from the health insurance sector, which gained ground after the Democratic presidential candidate Bernie Sanders exited the race for the Oval Office. Sanders was a supporter of a Medicare for All policy, which would have ended private health insurance. Now, as for today, market participants may lock their gaze once again to the US initial jobless claims. Last week, initial claims more than doubled the previous record of 3.3 million, hitting a new one at 6.65 million. Now the forecast points to another 5.25 million claims, but bearing in mind that the virus situation in the US had been worsening day by day last week, we wouldn't be surprised if we get a new record. This would confirm that the damages in the US job market are worse than previously anticipated and may trigger another round of risk aversion. The preliminary University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for April may also attract special attention, as it may reveal how much consumers' morale has been impacted. Expectations are for a slide from 89.1 to 75, which will be the lowest since April 2013 and may add more fuel to investors' flight to safety. As for our overall view with regards to the virus saga, it hasn't changed. We repeat that even if equities recover some more on signs that the fast spreading is eventually leveling off, we will be reluctant to trust the long-lasting recovery. We maintain the view that it is too early to call for a peak, and that just a day with accelerating cases and deaths may be enough for market panic to return. As we noted yesterday, we believe that it is too early to call off the lockdowns, as such actions carry the risk for the virus to start spreading at an even faster pace. Now, although the other commodity-linked currencies were found higher against their US counterpart, the loonie traded virtually unchanged, perhaps as its traders stayed on guard for Canada's jobs data and the outcome of the OPEC Plus video conference meeting, both to be released and announced today. With regards to the employment report, expectations are for the Canadian unemployment rate to have surged to 7% in March from 5.6%, while the net change in employment is forecast to show that the economy has lost 350,000 jobs after gaining the 30.3K. This would be the worst print in Canada's history, at least since we can find data from, and may raise speculation for more stimulus by the Bank of Canada. On March 27th, the bank decided to slash interest rates to 0.25% and to launch a QE program in order to safeguard its economy from the effects of the coronavirus spreading. The Governing Council highlighted its readiness to take further action to support the economy and the financial system, but similarly with the RBA, they noted that the policy rate is now to its effective lower bound, which means that they are not willing to cut interest rates further. Maybe they will decide to expand their QE program if the spreading of the virus threatens even more the outlook of the Canadian economy. Having said that, though, even if the Canadian dollar slides on potentially disappointing employment data, its broader direction may depend primarily on movements in oil prices, as Canada is among the world's biggest oil-producing and exporting nations. Last week, both Brent and WTI skyrocketed on speculation that Saudi Arabia and Russia may eventually agree on new production cuts to stabilize the energy market, and thus it remains to be seen whether this will be the case today, and if so, whether the new cuts will be enough to offset the tumble in global demand due to the pandemic outbreak. Now, as for the rest of today's events, in the UK, we have the monthly GDP, the industrial and manufacturing production, and the trade balance, all for the month of February. No forecast is available for the GDP rate. While both industrial and manufacturing productions are expected to have grown 0.2% month over month from minus 0.1% and 0.2% respectively. The nation's trade deficit is expected to have widened to £6 billion from £3.72 billion. In any case, we believe that pound traders will prefer to pay more attention to data referring to the month of March, during which the coronavirus probably left more marks on the UK economy. The ECB meeting minutes and the US PPIs for March are due to be released as well, but bearing in mind that the ECB has already proceeded with more measures after its latest ordinary meeting, and that investors may prefer to focus on the initial jobless claims with regards to the US data, we expect both of these releases to pass largely unnoticed. Now, as for tonight, during the Asian session Friday, we get China's CPI and PPI for March. The CPI is expected to have slowed to 4.9% year over year from 5.2%, while the PPI rate is anticipated to have entered negative waters. Specifically, it is expected to have slid to minus 0.1% year over year from plus 0.8% in February. So, that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye from me. Have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.